addressing those things with our children. We should be proud of our deen. This is why we do this. Because if you ask many Christians, well, why do you have the tree? Why do you celebrate this? Why isn't the fat man come down the chimney? Most of them don't know. It is something that's just kind of been built into their culture for a long time that they no longer understand. If we are doing our job well as Muslims and as parents, we should be able to express this to our children, even those who are very young, in a way that they will inshallah understand. Probably when they're very young, not very much, because they want the presents, and I understand that. But the longer we wait, the longer the delay we have, then you have to have the conversation of, well, why doesn't Santa Claus come to our house? Why don't we do this? Not a good place to be. Yes, sister, go ahead.
I have a more challenging question by my daughter, saying that why we don't have a Christmas tree during Christmas, since the Christmas tree is a symbol of the birthday of a prophet.
Ooh, that is a tough and an interesting question. You could approach it in a number of different ways. If you wanted to be a little historical like me, you could talk about how that really, he wasn't born during that time, but it doesn't really make sense.
But we don't have a proof he was born or he was not born.
Right, exactly. That's
we don't have a data in our religion telling us when Jesus was born.
How old was your daughter?
My daughter is 18.
Okay, yeah. I was going to say she was 8. Well, that would be different. Again, it's one of those things where I would say, as a parent, like this, these are the rules in our house, this is what we celebrate, this is what we don't celebrate. I'm not going to tell anyone here, any parents here, how to practice their deen in their own home, but again, you need to think about things from the long term. One of the best things I ever heard an imam say is, especially, he was speaking especially to the converts and those who revert to Islam, is he said, you must pray well and show the deen in terms of praying your prayers. Because when you're gone, who will show your children how to do it? You need to pray now so your children will pray for you when you're gone. And that really struck me because I know I will be judged by how my children will practice their deen. That's something that's important. That was a concern for my in-laws when I married my wife. So for me, this is something that I'm going to try and instill very early on to my children. If that is something that makes you uncomfortable and you feel that it's strongly against the deen, then I would say you need to put your foot down about it. Children may not like that, but your rules, your house? Not an easy answer, but that's the best I can probably give you. Other questions? Yes?
Yeah, like sometimes on your job, you know, you feel that some people, like maybe it can be your boss, you know, who is kind of like has bias against Muslims or some, you know, immigrants, you know. How to deal in this situation? I mean, like you can confront with him, or you just listen and know what he's saying. And don't.
Is your question specifically if the person in question is your supervisor?
Yeah.
Okay. That is obviously a difficult situation. Again, this is where you have situations where you have CAIR or other organizations that have that legal background. Of course, discrimination against any religion or ethnic group in our country, thank God, is illegal. Which is not to say people don't do it, but you have a legal recourse there. If you feel that that is the case, and it's to the point where it's really disruptive or dangerous, not just dangerous, I mean, you know, uncomfortable for you, you have legal recourse. Before it gets to that situation, though, that is one of those things where, within your comfort level, you need to be able to address those things. When I worked in another place, I was often the only Muslim in the room, and I would hear very anti-Muslim, anti-Arab things. And people didn't know that I was a Muslim. So I was able to speak out and address those things in a way where it surprised people because they didn't know that I was a Muslim. I'm like, well, actually, that's not accurate. Or, you know, that's really not true, and here's why. But when it's your supervisor, that's a different thing. Again, if you feel that you're being discriminated against or you're not getting the promotions or you're not getting the accolades that you should, that is obviously against the law. And that is something where you really would need to take more of a legal aspect. Because that is against the law. Others? Yes, in the back.
How difficult was it for you after the conversion to Islam? And we know from a lot of lectures that a part of the brothers who reverse to Islam, they go back to their religion because of a lot of difficulties. They lose their families, friends, their close circles, and what we can do as Muslims.
Okay. Okay, that's a really great question, actually. One of the things, and one of the kind of goes to your question as well, what can we as Muslims do to really help the Ummah in general? It's been my experience that a good deal of converts convert for the wrong reason, which usually is, well, I meet this sister, I meet this brother, and I want to be with them, so I'm going to convert for them. My organization does relationship work. We work with couples a lot. One of the things that I often see with couples is that someone will convert for romantic reasons, which to me tends to be a recipe for disaster. You're not doing that for yourself, you're doing that for someone else. That can't really maintain itself. So that aside, just converts often need support. They often will have questions. There'll be that feeling of initial fire and fervor, and they're very excited about the religion. But then inevitably, they will see things that will confuse them or hurt them. It'll be Ramadan time, and they obviously don't spend Ramadan with their families usually. So, and then many of their friends may or may not be comfortable inviting them to their own homes, so they're alone during Ramadan, or they feel out of place at the mosque or what have you. And so the best thing that Muslims can do, especially those who have been in the faith for a long time, is to stretch out that hand to make them feel comfortable, replace that family and social circle that they have often had to give up. That's something I think more Muslims often forget, is that converts will often have to leave family and friends behind. And in the place of that, they need a strong social support network that will strengthen their deen, will strengthen their belief, their iman, in a way that will allow it to transition through those inevitable rough patches. So the best thing that Muslims can do is to give those converts a safety net that they've often given up. It's hard for converts to do that just by themselves. It's a very difficult thing. Oh yes, one more thing.
Yeah, there's I work as a driver, and I take people to therapy and doctor appointments. Another lady actually in Bloomfield Hills over here, she's Jewish, and she talks to me about every day, like 2-3 days a week, she's talking about my religion, because she knows I'm Arabic. Muslim, and I tell her, certain things and about religion and all that. And there was one day where I, actually a couple days ago, I think it was Friday, I gave her a few CDs, about the religion, what it's about and what it deals with and all that. And then she said she don't have a CD player. Obviously, she don't want to listen to it. So should I keep going at her, or should I just leave her alone? Let Allah take care of it?
Obviously, Allah will take care of it one way or another. That's, of course, how it will be. Do you think her heart is open to converting?
I believe so, because like at least every other day she'll ask me about something, where I'm from, what you're doing, who's your family, all these things. And she's telling me about Jesus and all the other prophets. And something I actually learned something from her is that the Jews think that Jesus is actually a prophet, and I thought they didn't believe in Jesus. So we both learn from each other, but she does keep asking me about it. So.
Well, again, there's a couple things to keep in mind. If this doesn't violate anything regarding your job, if you think that's something that she's not going to be offended by, you can maintain the work relationship that you have,
right,
and you feel comfortable about it, and she seems comfortable about it, inshallah, maybe continue that if you have that level of comfort. But if it is something where maybe there's a work policy that you can't do that or what have you, I don't understand, various policies some organizations may have, maybe be cautious about that. But if you think maybe it's something that can produce good results, inshallah, I would encourage you to.
She's the one that asked me first, so maybe I can continue.
Just make sure you check your your work rules and just
right,
make sure.
Right, right,
yeah,
right.
Make sure you check it.
I got you.
Okay. Time for one more question? Okay. Yes.
Just a follow up on my previous question. You said Islam spoke to you. What was about Islam that made you think that this is it and not something else? I mean, it seems like. No, looking at the social situation, there are a little bit more limitations for everybody, but especially for somebody who has a lifestyle and you didn't have to worry about whether you're talking to a woman or not, and the 5 times of prayers every day. Why Islam again?
I want to address something that you said earlier, though, that because I've heard Muslims say this, well, Islam is so hard, there's all these rules and limitations. I always kind of take issue with that. I'm not trying to be insulting or anything, but I know a lot of Muslims will say that, well, Islam's so hard. Well, why would you do this? I never really saw it that way. Like, again, I consider myself a pretty disciplined person, and that appealed to me. Like, the order of things was appealing to me. the Tawheed, the oneness